Board of Commissioners for January the 30th of 2020 will begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We're going to begin this morning with a special presentation. I'm going to turn the meeting over to our Vice Chair of the Commissioners, Kevin Barnhart, who is also the Chair of Census 2020. Commissioner?
Thank you, Commissioner Linebaugh. Good morning. We're going to do a brief presentation. Mike Olmbeski, our traffic planner, and myself, who is basically spearheading a lot of the back office support of Census 2020. Thank you, Mike. We want to keep people apprised of any kind of changes or modifications of what's taking place with Census 2020, which happens every 10 years. Happens on April 1st of this year, counting you one time at the place of your residence, where you are at on April 1st and where you are living. We want to continue the process of recognizing that an undercount severely impacts the amount of federal money that comes back to Berks County. Our estimated undercount at the last census was 16,715 people, which each person accounts for $2,100 in lost federal money each year. 134 different federal programs are based on census data that come back to Berks County. That's $351 million of lost federal money to Berks County. And what we found out a few weeks ago, that this census is going to be critically different than any of the other ones. Many people will receive a postcard, several postcards in March, requesting you go online. You'll have a special number to go online, which identifies your house, your residence. Go online and fill out the 10 questions. But in Berks County, there are going to be some different variations of everyone getting postcards. Some people will receive a postcard and the form, and some people will receive both in English and Spanish. We want to put some maps up this morning so people are aware and proactive when this occurs. And I think a lot of the mapping is relative to the fact that there's an assumption that they don't have internet access. So Mike's going to go into some of the details of the maps. So thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Good morning to the board, to our audience, and to our television viewers. As everybody has been informed by now, the census is coming. But what has been made unique for this time around, as the commissioner alluded to, internet is now going to be an option for responding to your census on April 1st. The Census Bureau is very strongly encouraging online participation. It'll be easier to complete than worrying about paper. It will save that paper, save time. Ultimately, it will save money. Taxpayer funds are used to process all these forms, as well as go after folks who do not complete a form. Not everybody will be receiving the same type of information from the Census Bureau. In the past, every household received their form, and you were requested to fill it out and mail it back. Now there will be four different ways for the Bureau to reach out to individuals. Most folks will receive a mailer, not necessarily a form, just a postcard. It will have a unique identifier to your home address, asking you to complete the census online. Some will receive both a mailer and an actual census form to complete. And we'll get into the whys and hows in a couple seconds. Others will receive that postcard only, but it will be bilingual, English and Spanish. And then the fourth option, some will receive both the mailer and a form in both English and Spanish. What has happened is when the Census Bureau initially said they wanted to promote internet access, they realized very quickly that internet will not work for everybody. Additionally, there will be language issues. As far as internet working for everybody, what they did was they looked at households where internet subscribership may be low. There are a preponderance of elderly persons who may not use the internet. So they took all these factors into account, and what they determined nationwide, but also here in Berks County specifically, we're going to have three areas where people will have the possibility of receiving more than just a postcard. In general, the light purple that you can see throughout most of Berks County, people will receive just that mailer, and that mailer will be in English. In the city of Reading, the College Heights, Hampton Heights area, and also the 18th Ward south of Lancaster Avenue will receive just a mailer and just in English. The dark purple areas there will receive both the mailer and a paper form. They will be in English. North Central Reading, parts of Western Reading, and a good part of the 18th Ward. They will get that in English and Spanish, or I'm sorry, I've got new glasses here. they will get the mailer in both English and Spanish. The light green areas will receive mailer and paper in English. Dark green areas there, which is a majority of the city, will get the mailer and the paper form in both English and Spanish. Owing again to the fact, language barriers and internet access. Second area where we will have possible choice is the southern part of Spring Township, south of Goose Lane and Chapel Hill Road. They will receive both the mailer and the paper form in English. And thirdly, Boyertown Borough will receive that mailer and the paper form in English and Spanish. All of this information will be appearing in everybody's mailboxes about a week prior to Census Day, which is April 1st. If you want more information on how the Census Bureau decided on these areas, or you want to get more detailed mapping, just do a web search on 2020 Census Mail Contact Strategies, and that will take you to the Census Bureau's website. The web address is very long, and printing it up here would not have been much help. So just do a web search on that. Remember, as Commissioner Barnhart alluded to, 10 years worth of federal funding is dependent on this count. So we need to make sure that everybody counts here in Berks County. Are there any questions from anybody?
Is this going to be posted on our website?
We were hoping we'd get the compliance for our website, posted up on the website.
Okay.
Guys okay with that?
I'm fine with that. Good. I think this is good information. People can get a pretty good idea of where they are relative to what they're going to be receiving.
And the Census Bureau is still looking for enumerators. They're paying $19.50 an hour, I believe it is.
Yes.
For enumerators, we're still critically short of enumerators through the Census Bureau, the ones that actually come out and knock on the door with the form. And for those who do not have internet access, do not have access to a computer, and get the postcard, all of our libraries, the 19 and its four branches, all will have access, computer access, and they will guide you at least to get you started once you bring that postcard in, put your identifying number in. The librarians have really stepped forward, has been the first community group that stepped forward and said, we really want to help to do an accurate count. So anyone not have access or know people who don't have access who still want to go online, those services will be provided by our member libraries, and I really appreciate their support.
Since there's a lot of information to be shared, if the board agrees, why don't we publicize some kind of a link on the front page directing to a census page?
I'm fine with that, making it as easy as we possibly can. I want to compliment Commissioner Barnhart. You've been working on this. I mean, we've all been aware of it and we support it, but you've been working on this for over a year already.
October of 18.
That's what I thought.
Mike gave me that phone call and said, I need your support. Okay. But it's been a really great learning experience and education for me, and really to recognize how critically important this is. A lot of groups talk about the congressional, you know, how important it is. We've really focused on what it means in dollars and cents to bring back to our community. Right. I think that's more impactful for people to understand. This covers 134 different federal programs, and we, not ashamed to say it, we send that money to Washington, we deserve to get it back. So
sure.
That to me is all important. So thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mike. Good work. I want to note that we had three executive sessions. We had one on January the 28th on personnel, one on January the 29th on personnel, and one shortly before this meeting also on personnel. Are there any additions or corrections for the January 23rd, 2020 Commissioner Meeting Minutes and Budget and Ops Meeting Minutes? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. Is there any public comment on specific agenda item? If you can state your name, where you're from.
Yeah, Jess Royer, Spring Township. It's not about an agenda item. It's just that the agenda for today wasn't on the website this morning. I do want to mention that. Okay.
There were some technical issues.
Gotcha.
It is posted.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
We were appointing you to a board or a commission. Are you okay with that?
Okay. Under agenda, item one, authorizing budget department, adopt a resolution authorizing 2019 budget transfers in the amount of $10,301, 2019 appropriations in the amount of $8,218, and 2020 budget transfers in the amount of $68,262 per listing dated January the 27th of 2020. We have three items listed under Human Resources. Item one, authorize the appointment of Nicole Schwamberger to social worker at the Berksheim. Item two, authorize the promotion of Ashley Showers from Planner 2 to Assistant Director of Planning in the Planning Commission. And item three, a salary adjustment for Caitlin Rentschler. We have one item listed under Commissioner Barnhart. Adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Donald Mull, Reading, PA, to the Berks County Solid Waste Authority to fill the unexpired term of Dale Ann Farina. This term will expire December 31st of 2021. Under the Commissioners, adopt a resolution of the Board of Commissioners declaring an emergency to exist with respect to defective sewage pump electrical equipment at the Berks County Jail, and authorizing acceptance of the proposal by Pagoda Electrical Inc., Reading, PA, in a not-to-exceed amount of $26,911 to replace and repair the faulty equipment. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute a letter to McTish, Kunkel and Associates out of Allentown, granting extension of time of 5 1/2 months for completion of construction inspection services of the Drybulbis Station Covered Wooden Bridge Rehabilitation Project until July 31st, 2020. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute a letter to P. Joseph Lehman, Hollidaysburg, Pennsylvania, granting an extension of time of 12 months for the completion of Part 4 of the Drybulbis Station Covered Wooden Bridge Rehabilitation Project until November 30th of 2020. Item D, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the organizational facility credentialing application and W-9 form for AmeriHealth Caritas regarding the Berksheim Nursing and Rehabilitation. Item E, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of the memorandum of agreement regarding 1-year contract extension between the County of Berks and the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, District Council 88, Local 462, on behalf of court-appointed, court-related, and residual bargaining unit employees expiring December 31st of 2020. Item two, a motion authorizing the execution of contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator as set forth on the attached listing dated January 28th of 2020. There are a total of 9 contracts, one with the Area Agency on Aging, one with the Berks County Jail and the, jointly with the Berks County Jail and Berksheim, one with the Budget Department, one with Children and Youth Services, one with Juvenile Probation, one with the Berks County Library System, one with Mental Health and Developmental Disabilities, and one with the Public Defender's Office. And then a motion to ratify and confirm payments is set forth in the Comptroller's Office voucher listing. It's dated January the 28th of 2020 for the week ending January the 29th of 2020, and the payment of electronic transfers and employee payroll.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Second.
The motion has been made and seconded to approve the agenda. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion is carried. Turn to Dennis Adams, our county treasurer, for the treasurer's report.
Good morning.
Good morning, Dennis.
Good morning.
We have an opening balance today of $153,926,990.62. A balance to clear of $4,825,933.54, leaving us with a total of $149,101,057.08.
Thank you. And Ron Rutkowski sitting in for Sandy Graffius with the Comptroller's Report.
Thank you, Commissioners. For the week ending January 29th, we had a total disbursements of $6,894,369.06.
Very good. There is no budget and operations meeting this afternoon, so we'll turn to our Chief Administrative Officer, Ron Seaman.
Thank you, Commissioner Linebach. Just one item I'd like to share. I received from Stephanie Shirk, the Client Relationship Manager for Penn State Extension Office in our region, Area 9, an article by Amy Duke, dated January 15th of this year, that highlights a study that was done. Scientists examined potential economic impact of the spotted lanternfly in Pennsylvania, and it's projected that the state of Pennsylvania's economy could take a potential hit of $324 million.
Annually.
Correct. I've asked Lori Schneider from our IT department to put the link to the full article on our face page of our website. The article itself does give you links to more studies and more information about the lanternfly. And then coincidentally this morning from Penn State Extension, I'm on their mailing list for my pesticide license. I got a notification there's a spotted lanternfly public meeting being held in Lebanon County, Penn State Extension Office, 2120 Cornwall Road on Tuesday, April 14th. If anyone's interested in this, any orchard growers or anybody who potentially is affected, I strongly recommend that you check into this article and take advantage of the public meeting.
Good information. Commissioner Barnhart.
Thank you, Mr. Linebach. I forgot, we still have additional RAC cards denoting some of the real high points about Census 2020. We do have Spanish ones on the way. A lot of our social service, human services agencies have taken these and distributed them to their clients. And I'm joined here with my job shadow, Josh Adam Wise, sitting with Mary Kozak. He found me on Career Pathways website, which I support from the intermediate unit. Josh is a student at the Janus School in Lancaster and also at Harrisburg Area Community College, and wanted to explore opportunities with the county. So he's spending the morning with myself, Mary Kozak, tax claim, and the assessment office. Don't ask me why he wanted to mill around the third floor. Usually people want to come in to see pictures at the coroner's office and take a tour of the jail, but he has a different...
And find out where Stone Willie is.
Yeah, Stone Man Willie down at 3rd and Penn. So welcome, and hope you learn a lot today.
Yeah.
Welcome. Good to have you. Commissioner Rivera.
Yes, just want to touch briefly on two things. One, last night was the Berks Library System Award Ceremony. Commissioner Barnhart and I were there, and I want to congratulate all the library employees that won an award last night. It was a great night there. Congratulations to them. And also on Friday, we had the 2020 Greater Reading Chamber Alliance Commissioners Update Breakfast, where they spoke about a new program they have on talent attraction. And also want to congratulate Gail Landis, who officially retired from the chamber. I worked with her many, many years, and she was a great asset to the chamber and to the county as well. Congratulations, Gail.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I don't have anything. Anything from our row officers? Public comment.
Good morning again, Commissioners. My name is Jess Royer. I'm from Spring Township. This past Tuesday, local candidates all across the country, are getting their signatures to be on petitions right now. Pennsylvania's primary election is going to be on April 28th this year. It's going to be dominated, of course, by the presidential election, but unfortunately, that takes a lot of energy away from local issues, and it's just part of the beast of the presidential election being a much more visible election. And one thing that we have seen locally that often does not get coverage but is fortunately being talked about right now is youth homelessness. As recently reported by the Eagle, there are over 2,000 homeless youth in Berks County right now, and that number is likely low due to self-reporting and the stigma attached to being homeless, the definition of homeless being not having a consistent place to spend the night. So there are a lot of people who might have a place to sleep. It's at a friend's house, it's at a relative's house, but they do not consider themselves to have a consistent residence at night. With that in mind, there was a local effort at the Olive Boys and Girls Club that I was fortunate enough to be a part of that we put together 1,000 bags of toiletries that were donated by community partners and individuals who wanted to help, and then are being distributed to area schools. It was a great effort. There was a great turnout. There were a lot of volunteers and community partners who took part in it, and 1,000 bags, it was a lot of work. People had the day off of work. They were able to do that. That's not even half of the local homeless population, and that's a bag that will help one time. So I think this is an issue that does bear a lot of does require a lot of attention, and it should be talked about. And one idea would be to actually redirect some county resources in terms of the Berks County Residential Center, a facility which is currently being used as part of ICE's federal immigration policy, that we could actually have a local impact and do something that our community needs. This would be another idea that I think should be explored as something that we can do locally to help our local population and not be a part of failed immigration policies. Thank you.
Thank you. For the record, the latest data that we have, I spoke about this at the chamber breakfast on Friday morning, I believe is for 2018. It was a little over 1,900, and a lot of people assume, well, that's overwhelmingly the city. There's a lot, but over 900 of those students are outside of the city. And I found out about this last year at a BCIU session on youth homelessness, and I was shocked. I understood the definition, but then to hear the stories of families who live in their car because they've lost their home, or the one, and I'm trying to remember, 11, 12-year-old boy comes home from school and there's a note in the kitchen from his parents telling him he's on his own, they're gone. And this happens right in our own community. Over 1,000 here in the city of Reading. BCIU is aggressively addressing this. I put together a follow-up meeting because our MHDD department is actively working on this, and our children and youth services are actively working on this issue. But I appreciate you bringing that up. It is an important issue, and it's one of those things that for most people flies under the radar. They don't realize that, and here's the other thing. There may be homeless people around you, but because we think a homeless person means they're in a tent by the river or something like that, they don't realize that homelessness can be a family bouncing from a friend's house to another family member's house to another friend's house, and they have no place to stay on a permanent basis. So thank you for bringing that up. Other public comment? Your name and where you're from.
Evelyn Morrison, Reverend Evelyn Morrison, Reading, Pennsylvania. Gentlemen, it's important to say Happy New Year to you, and congratulations, Michael, and congratulations, Mary. I look forward to seeing your strategies in place. I'm here for two reasons. The last time I was here, we were talking about children and youth services, and I would like this year for an evaluation of compliance to or monitoring to be done. It's really, really important to see how families of color are being impacted. And when we look at the homelessness, or we look at crime, juvenile and adult, I was glad to see that the federal government is partnering with the state and partnering with the local law enforcement to see. Now, I saw John there, but he wasn't in the lineup, but it was important to see them working together. And the missing link there is the community. So the community has to stay involved and be involved when we're talking about crime prevention, intervention. Now, the local police, new police chief, had a press conference at Second and Olie yesterday, and it was real interesting to see how they say level one crimes are down, but yet there's no focus both on the federal level and the local level on the white collar crimes, crimes that impact the economic development of a community. And we need to look at, when we see, say, economic development, we have to look at community development in the whole. And we have partnerships there. I did a thumbnail sketch of our partnerships, Berks Alliance, Berks Greater Berks, the economic development piece. They all come together, basically, same member, same board, even Alvernia College, same member, same board. I like them working together. But when we went to the HR of each one of those businesses, we found sore lacking, that people of color are not employed in those 20. There's 20 members that own businesses, and when you look at each one of their HR or EEO1, you're missing brown and black people in management, in supervision, in a way in which human relations, the Pennsylvania Human Relations Commission would say systemic discrimination or employment discrimination. Now, it brings it home to Berks County. I want you to review your own EEO1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and see out of the 2,000 some odd 100 people working for the county, just indulge me for one more minute, for the county, who's working, what their positions are, what their gender and race is, and then look at ways in which you need to really increase the recruitment and training. So gentlemen, this is not a new issue, we've been talking about this for a while, but I'm hoping with some new people, there will be some new enhancement done so that we can see more of equality.
Thank you
so much.
Any other public comment?
Motion to adjourn.